I'm calling the Newington Town Council meeting of May 9, 2017 to order. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You have the roll call, please, while I adjust the volume.
Counselor Annis.
Here.
Counselor Budrego.
Here.
Counselor Delbuno.
Here.
Counselor Klett.
Here.
Counselor Menke.
Here.
Counselor Marocchini.
Here.
Counselor Nagel.
Here.
Counselor Sarah.
Here.
Mayor Zartarian.
Here. Next item is approval of the agenda. Can I have a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Okay, second?
Second.
Counselor Nagel. Discussion. Counselor Delbuno.
Like to move the executive session that is scheduled, it's item 15, and switch it with item 16, so executive session would come after remarks by counselors.
Okay. Is there a second to the, second by Counselor Menke? Any discussion? All in favor of the change, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Any other additions or modifications to the agenda? If not, all in favor of the agenda as amended, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, that's, agenda is set. Next item, a bittersweet moment. We recognize our town engineer, Chris Greenlaw, as he goes out the door. Come up here, please. Chris, come on up here.
All the way up.
Chris, you're leaving us after 15 years. We do have a proclamation in your honor here. Whereas Christopher Greenlaw has served the town of Newington in the engineering department since January 2nd, 2002. And whereas Mr. Greenlaw has served as the town engineer since 2011, having previously served as an engineering technologist and assistant town engineer for Newington. And whereas Mr. Greenlaw received an associate's degree in civil engineering technology from Hartford State Tech, a bachelor's degree in natural resources from the University of Connecticut, and a bachelor's degree in civil engineering technology from Central Connecticut State University. And whereas during his 15 years of service, Mr. Greenlaw served as an agent to the Inland Wetlands Commission and as a town liaison to agencies such as CROG, DOT, DEEP, and the MDC. And whereas Mr. Greenlaw played an integral role in the public works team and designed, estimated, and assisted in project administration, prepared project estimates and long-range budgets for various projects such as the roadway construction and mill overlay program, drainage improvement, sidewalks, and stone walls, among many others. And whereas, through his skilled leadership and immense knowledge, Mr. Greenlaw has successfully accomplished the design and engineering of many successful projects, including drainage and flood control at Badger Field, Timber Lane, Connecticut Avenue, Brentwood Road, Howard Street, Netty Lane, as well as the deep, low-impact development project located at the Clem Lemire Field parking lot. And whereas Mr. Greenlaw is resigning from his position of town engineer for the town of Newington, effective May 12, 2017, in order to pursue other career opportunities, now therefore be it resolved that the Newington Town Council hereby recognizes and extends its sincere appreciation to Mr. Christopher Greenlaw for his 15 years of exemplary service to the town of Newington, wishes him many fruitful years of health and happiness, and best wishes for his future endeavors. Dated in Newington, Connecticut, this 9th day of May, 2017. Signed, Roy Zartarian, Mayor, on behalf of the Town Council. Have a motion for the resolution.
So moved.
Second.
And moved by Counselor Mackey, seconded Counselor Maricchini. Any discussion? Counselor Maricchini.
I'll just say, reiterating the words in the motion that, you know, thank Chris very much for his service. I've had the pleasure of working one-on-one with Chris for town stuff in my early ages of getting involved in Newington town politics, with the Market Square streetscape, I believe, and I can't remember his name now, your predecessor. No, not Ed. What was his name? Yes, Tony. So we did great work there, and anytime I had a question about anything, Chris was always able to call, and we had good lengthy discussions about fun engineering stuff, so the kind of stuff I like to do, you know, roads. So again, you know, bittersweet, but good luck, and thank you for your service, and hope you and your family are doing well. Thank you.
Counselor Annis.
Well, Chris, I've also had the pleasure of working with you, and we're going to really miss the knowledge and the history you have of this town. You can ask you any question. You don't even have to look in a file. You know at the top of your head, and that's going to truly be missed by all of us. And I just wish you best of luck in your new employment, and I know that you're going to do well and you're going to succeed in anything you do in the future.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Councillor Klett.
I haven't worked as closely as maybe some of the other councillors have, but I've watched you from afar, and your dedication, commitment to the town, and your intellect, because you don't come to the table without all the information, and we're proud of him. I'm sure you're very proud of him as well. It is a loss, in my opinion, losing you to Bloomfield. I'm, you know, happy for Bloomfield, but I feel very sorry for us to see you go. I wish you well, and you know, you're admired.
Thank you very much.
Counselor Nagel.
Chris, I'd like to offer my congratulations to you for moving on. We're sad to see you leave, and I've had many experiences being educated by you and all your professional abilities in terms of many different projects over many years, and have been enlightened, and also have been able to have a social relationship with you at various different times. And discovered that we have people in connection from in the past. I don't know how I'm going to be able to contact my old schoolmate, buddy from when I went to high school back in the dark ages, which Chris happens to be related to. But we will be sorely missed, and we know that your new line of work will do you well, and we do wish you well, and don't be a stranger. And we appreciate all that you've done over the number of years that you've been here. Once again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Councilor Pedrico.
Well, it's obviously evident that you know your stuff, and to anybody in town, from your leadership and the projects that you've either led or been contributed to, you know, your work has just been wonderful. But what I personally appreciated is you're very even-tempered. I don't know if that he's like that at home, but
he does have two boys.
Yeah. you listen, and you're patient, and you explain. You never made me feel like incompetent or whatever, because engineering is, you know, quite a skill, quite an expertise. I really did enjoy working with you, and I guess your engineering doesn't just contain itself to the town, because I see you engineered a color-coordinated there. I don't know whether that was on purpose or whatever. But anyways, you'll be missed, Chris. Thank you.
Super, thank you.
Councilor Mankey, then Councilor W. Now.
I first met Chris when I joined the Conservation Wetlands Commission, and probably the first two meetings or so, I kind of looked like a deer in the headlights, because it was a lot of information, but I did appreciate the way that Chris took the time to explain things, not just to me, but to the rest of the commission. He did it in a calm, sage manner, where he would explain it and explain it and explain it until finally I got it. I also appreciate his stewardship of our town. He has had our town's best interest at heart at all times, and I think that's important for someone in his position. I also appreciate his personal support. He would always, after the meeting, and, you know, say, you should say something about this or speak up more, and I do appreciate that. I wish you success in the future. The town will certainly miss you. I think I'll miss you. I think people around this table will certainly miss you. But moving on and moving up is always a good thing. So I will miss you, and I'm sure we will all miss you.
Thank you.
Chris, like everyone here has said, we will be missing you as you take on a new endeavor, and I applaud you for considering it. I know when you've been in a position for a while, it's sometimes difficult to look on and move on. So I applaud you in the idea that you're willing to try something new like that, and I wish you the best. We will miss you terribly here. You really do bring a wealth of knowledge, and as someone else said, history that many don't have, that haven't been here as long as you have. I know there was and I'm thinking of one particular agenda setting meeting where we were talking about a topic and a lot of people around the table were like, oh, we don't have that. We've looked for that. We don't know it. And there was one call from Tanya to you, and in you walked with a folder this big of all kinds of information, and you sat down and shared everything out, and we knew exactly where we were going within, 10 minutes time. And that kind of experience and knowledge will be something that will be difficult to deal without. But I wish you the best. I hope you understand how much we all appreciate you. You've heard all of our comments, so I'm hoping you get it. But and too bad we didn't do this a week ago or 2 weeks ago, maybe he would have stayed. But just leave knowing that you were very well cherished here, and we wish you the best.
I just want to say I can't believe I've known you since 2002. Neither of us has changed a bit since. But I've always appreciated working with you. You knew your stuff. You were ready to answer, always helpful. And as others have said, you are going to be missed. You're leaving a big hole in the lineup. So somehow we'll struggle through, but it'll be tough. Would any member of the public like to speak to this resolution? Ms. Lane.
With your permission, I'd like to present Chris with our clock.
Oh, of course. Remind you, tempus fugit. Time is fleeing.
Chris, I know you didn't want a lot of fanfare when you were leaving, but you have to assume that with a proclamation also comes a clock. You do know this is our tradition here at Town Hall, and after 15 years of service as a dedicated and loyal employee, we would be remiss if we didn't do this for you. So I do recognize your service to town, and I would also like to recognize the fact that you combine those rare qualities, your knowledge of engineering and design and the complex calculations, and that combined with your understanding of the politics in a municipal setting. I think those are two rare qualities, and we will be hard-pressed to try and replace those. So congratulations to you. Thank you for your service, and Godspeed.
I saw Ms. Lyons coming up to speak to the resolution.
Rose Lyons, 46 Elton Drive. As a member of the public who is often at the Conservation Commission meetings, I've given them up for a while, run too long these days. I have to admire your patience with sitting through those meetings at times and your patience with me. I'm wondering if I withdraw my request for the terminus at Elton Drive, if you'll withdraw your resignation. I will continue to try and get the lights back on Constance Lee Drive. I hope this isn't a trend. You know, it's not easy training a new town clerk, a new assessor, and now it's going to have to be a new town engineer. You're going to have to put my picture up in that office of yours and say, when you see this lady, come and run the other way. But I really truly do appreciate all your patience with my questions and everything that you've done for us in the town. And as has been said before, Newington's loss is going to be Bloomfield's gain, and good luck to you. I certainly do hope that you have the best of times in your career in Bloomfield. Thank you.
Anyone else from the public like to speak to the proclamation? Okay, before I turn the microphone, Mr. Payne.
Chris, congratulations, and I wish you good luck in your future endeavors, and you're a wealth of knowledge that's going to desperately, that's going to be very missed here in town. But I wish you the best, and congratulations.
Thank you. Okay, before I turn the microphone over to the honoree, we do need to vote on the resolution. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Good, it's unanimous. Now it's your turn to say a few words.
Thank you, Your Honor. You certainly didn't make this easy, and maybe if you had talked to me a couple of weeks ago. In all seriousness, it's very bittersweet. You know, 15.3333 years, by the way, goes by fast when you're doing so many things. And usually my perspective has been from that end of the lectern, and as Councillor Klett said, I'm usually here with reports and analysis and data, and tonight I was prepared. With a couple of comments and just 5 or 6 pages. No, I want to acknowledge all of you. You know, it's truly been an honor to be your town engineer, to be your residence town engineer, and that meant a lot to me. Sometimes I looked at the office as the office of engineering and try and I hope when I leave, I've left the office better than the way I found it with the rest of the town. The other people I have to thank are my family, because there's meetings like this. You are all volunteers. You're all very dedicated. You're on streetscapes committees. You're on commissions. You're on council. It's a lot of time, and our families support us. That's very important. Department heads, you have a professional staff, and I'm not going to acknowledge anyone in particular because I don't want to forget anybody, but we had would change of leadership and change of managers. The department heads hold the line, and we've been here, we're dedicated, we have a lot of time. I just want to mention that to you. One thing I want to mention about the proclamation is really, you gushed about me a little bit, I want to gush about you, and that is the Howard and Eddy drainage project. When I first came here back around 2002, Keith Chapman hired me. We just didn't have some flooding problems, and it's not relevant too much now because we've had 2 years of drought. But when I first came, Mike Mancini was a director. And I think the Howard and Eddy project really exemplifies how government works, and I think that's important. And we just didn't have flooding. We had areas in town that, when I say flooding, it was actually adversely impacting households. And I want to share with you, because some of you have some significant time here, and I think it's important to note. I brought some pictures, and these pictures are from Howard and Eddy. And you'll look on the back, you'll even see a council meeting. And you might not want to repeat the date, but the thing is, we did listen. And how the system worked was we had residents go to the manager, we had residents go to council, we had a council meeting in the field. It took a few years, but then through the process, and I know that Mancini at the time asked for a drainage improvement accounting fund, and you as a committee make those difficult decisions as far as balancing your funds. We had numerous locations in town, and when you look at those pictures there, you'll see, you know, the quantity of flooding that you had. And that wasn't the only project, but this one I think was very rewarding because everyone was involved, and the residents came to government, and you have a manager, and staff was directed, and the CIP committee gave us the funding. We did the design in-house. We built this project, or the restoration to the drainage was completed by town forces, and I think that is government, and that just exemplifies how it works. So that was rewarding for myself. That was a great project. I think it was a great project for the town. A couple others were mentioned. And moving forward, I think, you know, we would always chuckle now and then about, you know, it's a bad year, you know, as far as when we'd go before the CIP committee. But given the fiscal climate, I understand that, you know, this council really has to make some tough decisions. And the decisions you make today are going to yield dividends 20 years down the road for those residents who want to work and live in town. So it is appreciated. It does work. And I thank you for volunteering and caring so much about the town. And thank you for allowing me to be your town engineer. It's been an honor. So best wishes and God bless. Thank you.
Thank you,
Your Honor.
Next item is public participation, either in person or by telephone. If you're watching on NCTV, the number to call is 860-665-8736. If you'd like to speak, please come forward, state your name and address for the record. Please limit your remarks to 3 minutes. No one coming forward. One on the phone. Remarks by councilors on public participation. There doesn't seem to be any need for that. Next item is old business, appointment of the auditor. We are in the... Is that a phone? We are going into the second year, I believe, of a 3-year contract with Blum and Shapiro, but we do need to make the appointment every year. So we did discuss this at our last meeting. We have a resolution before us. Who would like it?
I'll do it.
Councilor Nagel?
A resolve per section 610 of the Newington Town Charter, the firm of Blum Shapiro is hereby appointed as auditor for the town of Newington for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2017. Said firm agrees to file a complete report on or before December 15th, 2017.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Sarah. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries 9-0. Okay. Daniel, you'll make sure Ann understands that this will be left for Ann so she knows that this is
absolutely
ready to go. Okay. Next item is the memorandum of understanding between the Town Council and the Town Plan and Zoning Commission on the issue of digital signs. We reviewed this at our last meeting. I did speak with the chair of Town Plan and Zone to relay the concerns of the council about one paragraph, which has subsequently been removed. And what we are doing with this is acknowledging that the authority over the digital signs remains with town plan and zoning. And, we have the draft memorandum of understanding before us. We have a resolution. Would somebody like to enter it? Councilor Del Buono.
Resolved that the Newington Town Council hereby authorizes Mayor Roy Zartarian to execute the attached memorandum of understanding regarding digital signage on town-owned property with the Town Plan and Zoning Commission.
For a second.
Second.
Discussion. Councilor Marichini.
I have one thing that kind of bothers me a little bit. Is that the end of the MOU? Basically, last paragraph of any digital signage on any town-owned property without the prior consent of TPZ. It just doesn't sit right with me. In my mind, the town council is the last governing body for the town. I don't necessarily want to give that up, so to speak. I don't mind, it has nothing to do with the signage. It just has to do with looking for TPZ's consenting to us.
My understanding, and we do have our liaisons to TPZ here and a member of the Zoning Commission here as well, that there is a prohibition on digital signs in the zoning regulations. Is that correct? Yeah. So basically, my reading of it is they're saying, yeah, we're going to adhere with the regulations. Yes, we realize you, TPC, have the authority over it.
But we shouldn't need their consent to do anything, technically. So if we took those few words out, I'm good with it.
I mean, this is a memorandum of understanding, which is not legally binding. I mean, I think it was just as kind of an agreement, this is the way we want the town to look. This is, you know, but it's not that it can't be broken or changed at...
Then we don't need their consent. So we could take that part out.
You got those last few words.
So just end it as signage on any town-owned property.
Period.
And then I'm good. I like the part where it says we're going to work together and all that good stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Yeah, just take out those last couple of words. So just be digital signage on any town-owned property, period, and delete without the prior consent of TPZ.
Clean up the coffee after.
I'm processing it right now.
Jay, I wonder what he's doing that for.
There's a vacuum cleaner going, too.
So the last paragraph, basically what is proposed is removing without the prior consent of TPC, the last 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 words, basically. So it would still be an agreement between TPZ and the council.
Yeah,
right. Yeah. But we just don't need...
Right. I'm fine with that.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So read, now therefore it is hereby agreed by between the TPZ and the town council. Town council shall not authorize the placement of any digital signage on any town-owned property.
Period.
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 Yep.
Everybody okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Even more restrictive than the original version when you stop and think about it.
I don't see it as more restrictive. I don't see it as more restrictive because without the prior consent,
can't hear anybody.
Talk closer.
I don't see it as more restrictive because when you include the portion that says without the prior consent of the TPZ, to me that leaves it open that the TPZ may decide to permit something. And therefore, I agree with Jim's comments, since it's the council that's elected by the public, not the TPZ. I don't believe that that's the way it should be.
All right. So we're all agreed on the the last paragraph.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. All in favor of the resolution? Let's do a roll call on this, please, Susan.
Are we doing it as amended?
As amended.
Right.
As amended.
Okay.
All right.
Councilor Anist?
Yes.
Councilor Budrejko?
Yes.
Councilor Del Buono?
Yes.
Councilor Klett?
Yes.
Councilor Menke?
Yes.
Councilor Marachini?
Yes.
Councilor Nagel?
Yes.
Councilor Sarah?
Yes.
Mayor Tartarian?
Yes. Passes 9-0. Okay, and I will touch base with the chair of town plan and zoning and arrange for the signing. One more off our list. Next item is new business. First item up is discussion on the Metropolitan District, and I see our two representatives are here. Would you please join us?
I'll stand here because I have a chair right here. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Two of us representing Newington are here. I just came back from my surgery, and I thought this is important to attend this meeting.
Ah.
And thank you that we are now working together, and manager's office is coordinating with everybody. And we are on the same wavelength. We both have talked about it.
You hold the microphone.
Yeah, we both have talked about it, and some of things which is represented, we both agree on it.
Okay.
So you want to add?
Yeah. I made a copy of Bill 6008 and a resolution that was passed by the MDC. It's in front of you. Before we get into that, I figured I'd discuss some water levels with you. We've had some droughts for the last few years, but last year at the peak of the drought, We were at 75%. The MDC was at 75% capacity, which is 30 billion gallons of water in reserve. The full capacity is 40 billion gallons. And we are, last month, we were, the MDC was at about 94.5%. And since the rain last week or so, we're probably close to 96% capacity. And just to give you an example of the 30 billion gallons left, it would have to not rain for 2 years before the MDC would run out. So there is a large capacity there that I think people have a misunderstanding of. I figured I'd give you an update on Cedar Street project, which is being currently scheduled. They took care of the easement problem on Cedar Street there, so that they could move forward. They've received a deep approval to advertise in early May, and that's been completed. Memorializing the hold harmless letter, the DOT to the town, and the noise waiver, and any other final paperwork will be worked with the town during the month of May and June. That's in progress. They plan on advertising in June of 2017, this year. The bid opening will be in July. Then the MDC will send the recommendation to award to DEEP in August. Likely get a response from DEEP in September. And then the execution process at the MDC will be in the month of October. And then notice to proceed would be in November. And that would allow all winter to do the shop drawings and the submittals and things like that. And the MDC is planning a public information meeting at the town of Newington Town Hall in the September of 2018 with all the stakeholders so that everybody is on the same page. The bill that I passed out, the 6008, that's been passed by the House and the Senate. And as amended, and the bill now awaits for the governor's signature. The bill is effective upon the passage, and it does the following, basically. It establishes an independent consumer advocate to serve customers of the MDC at the cost of $70,000 for the first year, and then $50,000 annually thereafter. A similar position was established by the Regional Water Authority in New Haven, another public water company, several years ago, and a private water company customers are served by the Office of Customer Counsel. The MDC had started this process of establishing this office by MDC ordinance last fall. This bill amends the charter, the MDC charter, to give the MDC additional tools to react to those situations where a member town defaults in its ad valorem tax payment. So as following, it allows the MDC to declare an emergency event of a loss of revenue and budget for that loss of revenue within the fiscal year. And then in addition to the present circumstances where we have to spend money for emergency conditions within the system, such as a major unanticipated water or sewer main break. It also extends the maximum term for tax anticipated notes from 6 months to 3 years and allows the MDC to use those proceeds, such notes, for working capital purposes to address situations where a town defaults. It also corrects the problem with it, where the towns had to put money aside for the reserves, where it directs the OPM to reduce a member's town state grant by the amount owed by the MDC for ad valorem tax and send that money to the MDC. So that corrects that problem. There's a resolution that the MDC passed. It's on the back page of the bill. and basically says that if the governor signs this, then the towns don't have to set any money aside anymore. When the problem with Hartford came up, it was also talked about where some of the towns wanted to do a study to see if the ad valorem was the best method, and or should there be a sewer usage tax. So the MDC is looking into that, and that's something that the MDC is going to come back to each town and see if they want to proceed with it after they gather some more information for you. The cost of that study for the eight towns is $254,000, roughly $31,000, a little bit more than $31,000 per town to put that together. That's not been budgeted in the MDC budget. So that's coming down the road. You'll probably hear from the MDC or myself on that. If anybody has any questions or down the road, you can reach me on my cell phone, 860-478-0854. Or if there's a member of the public that wants that has a question, they can email me at dpane6083 at gmail.com. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Clinton, Councilor Buttrago.
I was wondering if we could introduce the, I don't know, I'm sorry, I apologize, I don't know who you are, yeah. And maybe we could let the public know who the two commission members are.
Again, Bhupen Patel, I contacted manager's office and I told him her that we should be on the same page, contact and share our ideas and not necessarily rush into. In my opinion, MDC is run very fine machine and it is good, they are doing a good job, but at the same time, we have to keep eye on everything. And that's our job, your job, and our job too. We both work together on all issues which come up, we discuss it. My background is in engineering. I worked with MDC for years, and I was a member of Planning Zoning Commission for almost 17, 18 years here. So I know what we need for town zoning, planning zoning, as well as I know what our needs are with respect to sewer and water supply. Obviously, there are issues which needs to be resolved, and I think everybody's working together. All towns are working together. And sometime trouble comes in, it's just like what happened to Hartford. I thought some good resolution will emerge, and it did. And I think that's ultimate how region should work. And I don't know how many of you know, but MDC is basically all assets are City of Hartford's. It was City of Hartford's Public Works Department, which my last career I ended there. And that was many years ago. But forefathers of this region at that time, what they built only for Hartford has served entire region. And some, unfortunately, time have changed and Hartford is down a little bit. Everybody has worked together and helped each other and come up with a good solution. And hopefully state will also rise up to that level. And I think that's the regional efforts. Without Hartford, we can't survive. Without us, Hartford cannot survive. So it's a mutual interest for everybody. And so anybody, if any misunderstanding, as I mentioned, please call either of us. My number is, my cell number is 860-604-0401. And my email is bhupen1964@yahoo.com. And thank you for listening to us. And now I will pass it to you. Want to
Dominic Payne.
Good evening. My name is Robert Constable. I'm the director of finance at the MDC, and I'm here to support the two gentlemen as well as talk about monthly billing this evening.
Excuse me. Councilor Budrejko?
I just have a question on, I mean, I fully, I'm glad that these initiatives have passed the legislature, but now it's still awaiting the governor's signature, correct? I know, I do believe Hartford has guaranteed its payment through July, I guess. Now, do you know when the governor is going to sign this? And what will happen if it's not signed by July and Hartford goes under?
The MDC anticipates that it'll be signed before July. It's just waiting his signature. It passed the House. It passed the Senate. So, and this was proposed by the governor. So, so he should be signing it.
Okay, so it'll be affected upon his
signature.
It'll
be effective upon his signature.
Okay.
And it'll go into effect. If Hartford does default,
these new rules will apply
okay. immediately. And it basically meaning that the OPM will take out money before giving it back to the city of Hartford.
Okay. And I would assume MDC is going to be lobbying very heavily if the governor forgets to sign this on a timely basis. Okay, thank you.
Councilor Klatt.
Are we sure that it's going to be effective as soon as his signature? Because if it's, is it part of legislation for next year?
No, it acts immediately. Once the governor signs it, it'll go immediately into effect, is what we've been told.
Any other questions for the commissioners?
Going to monthly billing.
Yeah. Before we get into that, I just want to thank the commissioners for being here, and we look forward to seeing you back on a periodic basis. It's the first time we've done something like this in my recollection, so it's really working out well. And now we're going to hear about how we're going from quarterly bills to monthly bills.
Yes, so good evening. Thank you for having us tonight. Again, my name is Robert Constable. I'm the Director of Finance at the MDC. Part of my job, I oversee Treasury, Budget, and Financial Control, as well as Customer Service. Within the Customer Service arena, I also oversee billing. And over the years, we've been trying to streamline our whole customer service process and make improvements. We're currently going through a re-implementation of our SAP system to make things more efficient at the MDC. So hopefully to have some cost savings and headcount savings over time. We're supposed to be going live next February with our re-implemented system. But over the last couple of years, we made some changes to customer service and billing. So in July of 2015, we used to have Webster Bank used to be our bank. And at that point, people could pay for their monthly bill or quarterly bills through the bank. In July of 2015, we actually switched vendors. We went to using a vendor called Kubra. And what Kubra allowed us to do is for people to actually pay online and use their credit cards. So that was a big step forward for us, and that's been going very well. Currently, we have about 21,000 customers that are online paying their bills out of approximately 100,000 customers. In August of 2016, we revised our bill. So we went from a one-page to a two-page bill, but that bill is much more transparent than it was in the past. So the first bill that we used to have was basically a lump sum. You didn't get all the details of all the different service charges and so on. The new bill, the first page is a summary sheet, and the second page is all the details. So it's much more transparent, and we will continue to modify that as we go forward, but that was a very successful rollout as well. And then in February 17, we had talked about going to monthly billing. And part of the reason we've gone to monthly billing, as we discussed here, we've had some droughts over the years. And particularly last year was a very significant drought for us. But we had many customers, particularly I'll use West Hartford for example. West Hartford didn't get their September, they got their bills in September, which means they didn't get any knowledge of what they were consuming from June, July, and August. We had customers that had bills in excess of $1,000 for those 3 months, because people were watering their lawns and so on. And there was a big outcry of trying to go to monthly billing because, you know, I equate it to my kids. My kids come home, they turn all the lights on. Well, guess what? Next month, all the lights are off because I got to make up for that big bill I just got from Eversource. So, but going in with a quarterly water bill, you don't have that option. You have no control. So by going to monthly billing, it's going to allow people to manage that consumption better. You don't have to wait 3 months. It's also going to allow, you know, the lower income people, you're going to get a smaller bill. I mean, to get a $300, $400, $500 bill on a quarterly basis, people don't realize if you compare that to your phone bill, your cable bill, you know, the water bill is actually much lower. And a lot of people call and say, I got a $400 bill, but that's spread over 3 months, you know, versus getting your phone bill or, like I said, cable bill is, you know, far, far above that. So this will help us manage the receivables better. It'll help people be able to pay their bills better, you know, because now you're getting a $50 bill or a $60 bill. So that we think that's going to help overall down the road for not only us, but for our customers. So currently, the other thing I want to mention is on the monthly bill. So our current quarterly charge is $44.94. When we go to monthly bill, you're not going to get a monthly quarterly charge for $44. It's going to be $14 and change. So that'll still equal $44.94 over the quarter, but that fixed charge will be split by month. So there's some miscommunication on that as well. Newington is scheduled to go next month. You're my last town meeting. Mm-hmm. And so it's been very successful overall. We've had some people that aren't happy because they were happy with the quarterly bills. But I think this is going to be a benefit to everyone. We have more positive feedback than we've had negative feedback. So I think it's been very successful, both from, again, the customer service side as well as on the MDC side. So what's next? To give you a heads up, so right now, as part of this process, let me give you an idea. We used to have 64 cycles, and the cycle is a part of a town. So and our readers would have to go out and read all these different routes. We had 64 routes. So as part of this process, we've been able to redo all our routes because you have to remember back in the old days, people used to walk to read your meters, and that's the way the routes were set up. We can now drive, and we have readers within the card, and it can pick up 3, 4, 5 streets across. So the routes that we had, you know, that were very inefficient. So we've been able to redo all our routes. We're now down to 20 routes, and we can read approximately 10 to 15,000 meters in 2 days. So it's been a significant change. The expectation is we get further down the road, we're going to go to the radio frequency reads where you don't need to have to go out in your vehicle. That way we can reduce our meter staff. The goal here is to become more efficient and more economical for our customers. So with all the technology out there, we're trying to implement some of that so that we can reduce our costs. So we're able to rework the routes. The next thing we're going to be doing is coming out to all our customers, including Newington, to see if we can start consolidating our bills. We want to go to summary bills, if that works for you. Give you an idea, like State of Connecticut has, we have about 10 or 15 accounts for State of Connecticut. It'd be nice to send one bill to them. In some cases, we may not be able to, you know, Public Works might want to pay their own bill versus police department or what have you. But where we can, we're going to start reducing the number of bills that we're issuing. And like I said, we're going to be re-implementing our SAP system, so the next step in February is to also go to our e-billing. We want to offer online bills so people don't have to get hard copies anymore. So again, we're trying to push this out to all our customers to reduce our cost. One of the next things that we're also looking at is with Kubra, they have some options where people can actually go and pay their bills at CVS, Walmart, and other places. And we're also going to install some kiosks in certain strategic areas, so people don't have to drive into Hartford to pay the MDC. You can either pay online or you can run to your CVS. That'll also help, I think, with our customer base. Again, ultimately, we can start reducing our customer service facility. Most utilities are driving to get away from people coming in to pay their bills, and that way you don't have to have staff there and so on. What's the last thing? So the basic thing here is we're looking to become more strategic with our customer service. We have made some improvements, and if you have any feedback, if you deal with our customer service folks, or if you have questions about the bills, feel free to reach out to us, and I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Any questions? Is the online interface for paying bills going to remain the same?
Yes, it will. Even when we go to the new system, we still have to use Kubra because we're not allowed to accept credit cards.
Okay,
we'll still be using that service.
Councilor Anist.
I have a question, but it's about the Cedar Street project. When are they projecting it to commence?
In the spring of 2018, basically.
Okay, because then you said that they were going to have a public info in September of 18? So they're going to start the project and then do a public info?
No, they're going to do the information meeting before they start the project.
So September of 17?
I didn't say September. I said just early spring they're going to do the information meeting, and then after that they're going to go into the project.
Okay.
But they're doing the bidding and all that stuff and get ready. But I think just before they start the project, they'll do a informational meeting to let everybody know what's going on and let the public know what's going on and catch any problems before they start the work.
And people have chance to change their routes.
And by the easement, that means work in the intersection of Cedar and Willard will actually not be done in the middle of the intersection, but is that correct?
I think there is one section that will have to be done at night, but it's a reduced time. I believe it's a one-week period that the town of Newington allowed them to do. They have to cross this Willard Avenue there.
Yeah.
And it just it can't be done during the daytime.
Anything else? Councilor Dubino.
Just a thank you, because you were very succinct and clear about all the changes, and there was a lot of information that you just gave us, things that I wasn't aware of, so I appreciate the report on the billing and how that's all being changed. Thank you.
Anything else? Gentlemen, thank you for coming, and we look forward to seeing you in a few months.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and councilors. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is discussion social media policy, and I know this came up at leadership, and it's something I've been looking forward to. It's something the town doesn't have. My own concern is that at some point, the town may end up at the wrong end of a lawsuit because of something posted on Twitter or Facebook or whatever. My own thinking on this, granted it is my own, is that at some point we need to get a committee going, composition yet to be defined, to work in consultation with, say, the town attorney to come up with issues like who should be covered by this policy, what should the policy be, contact other towns, see what the examples are. That's as far as the thinking I've gotten on it. Now, I'm just throwing it open for general discussion, at least to get the ball rolling, and I hope we can get a resolution on it. Councilor Klett.
Well, I'm not sure, like, what kind of legalities there are, because the president, Trump, is on Twitter and Facebook on a regular basis, so I'd imagine that if there was some kind of legalities that cover social media policy, that wouldn't be happening. So I would guess that we would obey whatever the law is that states what's allowable by a municipality or a state with social media. And, you know, maybe we should get some feedback on that.
If I may, one extreme example I'm thinking of, and it just, again, completely hypothetical. A member of a regulatory body makes a comment on Facebook that is applicable to an applicant or an application or an action that the board is going to take. If the action were adverse to the applicant would then say, well, you've had predetermination of this case. Look at this quote by Commissioner so-and-so on Facebook saying we're a bunch of idiots or something like that. So that's the extreme example I'm thinking of. Councilor Del Buono.
I think when we're talking about this, you know, as Mayor Zartarian mentioned, talking about who this would apply to. So looking at whether it be town staff, whether it be commissioners, whether it be, you know, us, whether it be whomever it's applicable to, and whether that makes sense or not. So as you mentioned, having the town attorney involved, looking to other towns and places to see what kind of policies are out there to kind of look to begin the process. But, you know, I can speak to where I work. I know we have a social media policy where I work that we're expected to read and sign off on, that we understand what our constraints are in terms of our professional life and what we're able to and not able to post, who we're able to and not able to reach out to online. So as a teacher, like, I'm not supposed to have, for example, like on social media, any of my students or that kind of thing. So, you know, it's outlined in a way that is an expectation for the district that I work for. Just as this, I'm thinking in my mind, would be an expectation for the municipality and whomever it governs or covers. So, you know, I know what you're saying in terms of the law, and that obviously would have to be considered, but it can also just be policy. Is, you know, like Newington High School has a policy handbook, mm-hmm. That isn't governed by law, but it's what the expectation is.
Right.
I mean, so that's the way I'm looking at it.
Those are honest.
Tina, does the town have for employees, do they have a social media policy?
No, we don't. In fact, I think this may have come up maybe at agenda setting. So I have already had the town clerk contact. We have a blast email for the entire state. So I've gotten a lot of policies, code of ordinances relative to social media. So I do have a folder that I will hand over to whomever if this ad hoc
But that's
committee.
For paid employees, though.
I'm sorry?
Is that just for paid employees and not
no,
for...
No, I don't know. It's okay. Quite a bit of information. I haven't read through it.
Okay. Because I know there's going to be a difference between a paid employee right. and a volunteer or, you know, an elected official. But I would like to pursue to see, you know, what we can do to kind of prohibit it, because I am concerned about posting and preconceived notions on pending, neither be conservation, ZBA, TPZ, or any of them. I think, you know, we could get ourselves in a real mess down the road if we don't be proactive rather than being reactive.
Referendums. That's what really got to.
Yeah.
You know, you want to be out there supporting it or whatever, and we truly can't when we get to a certain point. So,
right.
If anything, it's just good to have it outlined so future people know what they should or should not do.
And we're always reactive.
Not volunteering for the committee, though.
No, we're always reactive. We should be proactive on something.
Yeah.
Councilor Mankey.
I mean, I see no downside of studying it, getting what other towns are doing and seeing how they're applicable to us and how we can adapt them to us. I would just think that if we do form a committee to look at all these, we should have all the stakeholders involved. So it's not just the council. You know, we should have maybe a couple of commissioners from committees or maybe some town employees, so they have some buy-in. So we aren't just looking at this just amongst us and then imposing it on the rest of the town. We should have people who are who is expected to cover should also have some part of some say in how we roll this out, or at least some feedback.
Councilor Klatt.
Yeah, I would suggest that we reach out to CCM, as they are the organization that, you know, represents municipalities, and I would bet that they probably have an understanding as to what towns have a policy regarding social media.
I believe that's already been done.
Yes, in fact, Jamie contacted CCM, and what we got back was a one- or two-page informational piece, and that's what led me to then have the town clerk solicit input from the other towns. So they didn't have an awful lot to offer. It's in the same folder, so you'll have copies of all of it.
Maybe they could tell us what towns have policies. Governing social media, that might be helpful.
Hey, anything else? Let's, as a chair, to get everyone thinking, we will revisit it. Should we keep it on the agenda and revisit it? Maybe next meeting may be too soon. Well, we can decide that at agenda setting.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to keep putting this off because we've been bringing this up for a while. So, I mean, I would like to.
All right. Yeah, sure. Absolutely. So let's keep it.
Let's keep it going.
Keep it in mind.
Keep it on the side burner, not on the back burner. Okay.
Yeah. I think the general consensus with the head nodding is that it seems worth just how you want to, which we can discuss that now, how you want to
set up the committee.
I think it's a perfect job for the majority and minority chair, quite honestly. That's just me talking.
That is just you talking.
It seems like that would be the place to go. For
okay.
That,
okay.
I mean, you can work on the setup of the committee and we can
go
from there, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
No problem. We'll handle it. We've got it. It's under control.
All right.
We'll talk about it and we'll bring our ideas to agenda and then we can work on a resolution to bring forward to the council.
Right. We'll keep it going then. We'll keep the ball rolling.
Okay. See how I just got that account?
That was nice. Good job. Good job, Jim.
From way down here.
Nice job. I'm impressed.
Okay, if there's nothing else, we'll move on to discussion of code of ordinances. Again, we are not introducing any ordinances today, not proposing any ordinances. Wanted to bring everyone up to date on what the town attorney is working on as the result of discussions by the council or by council leadership. He's looking at, and he has not yet been drafting, but researching, an ordinance for Don't Block the Box, an ordinance on panhandling, an ordinance on snow removal from hydrants on town property, and at the request of the Town Plan and Zoning Commission, he's working on a revision to the blight ordinance, which would empower the zoning enforcement officer to issue citations or tickets. I do not know whether that will replace the current process of reporting blight as is currently done through our blight queen sitting there at the end of the table.
Poor Jamie.
It's usually a busy time of year for that, I'm assuming.
Are there any comments, Councilor Budrejko?
I was just wondering, while he's doing his review, I noticed over the past several months, there seems to be an issue, and I don't know whether it's an ordinance or not, in terms of solicitation at people's houses. Someone said that there's an ordinance where it's they're allowed until 10 o'clock at night. I wonder if that should be reviewed and perhaps...
Really that late?
That's what Facebook said. But I know there's been an increase of complaints and concerns, and maybe that's one that you can add to the list.
That's a good idea.
Add that to the list and convey it to the town attorney for his research. He could not be with us tonight. He is eyebrow deep in litigation for a client this week. Councilor Annis.
I have a question regarding the solicitation. Do they have to get a permit from the police department?
I believe they do.
I believe that's required.
And do they get something to wear?
Yes.
That they have it? Because there's a lot of people out there that don't have anything.
Yes,
and
they
when
do.
And when I say, you know, have you gone and gotten a permit, they have not a clue that they need to do that.
I think anyone in the
public. Though,
no, they don't.
I think anyone in the public should, when someone comes to their door, ask, first of all, do you have a permit and do you have this badge? And if they don't have it, you say,
yeah, they
just
should
be
get
on
something.
Your way. Don't come back until... until you do have one, if indeed you need to. I have at various times just called the town up right after someone's come without that, just so that the police are aware of it, whether they can do anything or not, and at least be able to monitor the neighborhood so that everyone in the neighborhood doesn't have those not approved solicitations going on.
And the other thing, Roy, can you explain Don't Block the Box for the public?
Oh, Don't Block the Box is additional legislation that would penalize drivers who stop because of a red light in the middle of an intersection. You know, they have the stop bars painted right at the beginning of an intersection. This would keep an intersection open. One area of particular concern is the intersection of Myra Cohen Way and Fenn Road. And if you've been on Fenn Road during morning or evening rush hour, you know how the traffic can build up, which causes a problem for motorists trying to get into or out of the fast track station. And we're looking to that area for economic development. It is not going to help our cause if cars can't get in and out of there. That's one of the areas we want to specifically target. There are others in town that Chief Clark has identified as well. So that's why we want to go with the don't block the box to supplement the state law. Councilor Dubino.
I just want to say, just to clear it up, it would only be designated for certain intersections or areas in town. It wouldn't be every intersection. It would be specifically, there would be signage to reference it, as well as the painting of the street, as you said. But it really would just be looking at those high traffic areas that are of most concern, right?
Councilor Sarah.
I just have one question. You said the town attorney was going to be going over the blight ordinance. When we were in committee and we did the whole ordinance, Attorney Palomino was the attorney that worked with us on this?
On the blight ordinance. Mm.
Blight ordinance, right.
On the blight ordinance, yes. So why wouldn't
this cannot, Palomino? I just learned this from Attorney Ancona, that he had been requested by Town Plan and Zoning to draft a revision to ultimately come to the council.
Shouldn't it come to the committee first?
I'm sorry.
Shouldn't it come to the blight committee first?
Well, they're not all blight, right?
Well, it's blight ordinance.
Yeah.
Oh, the whole thing is?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I was going to suggest, I mean, I think it makes sense because it's more of a zoning enforcement piece that I don't know if it matters which attorney handles it, if he can do it, but I think you're right. I think it should come back to the committee to at least be part of the process and then come to the council. That's the structure we have in place. So I think that makes sense.
Making the note right now to convey that to the town attorney.
And it would make sense if Tony would do it because he has all the knowledge. He attended all the meetings. He's got the background information on it. So to me, instead of reinventing the wheel, trying to review notes and everything, just, you know, might be a quicker process. And Tony might know how to, you know, how to proceed the proper way, seeing he probably already looked at it once.
I think it's just a matter of communication or miscommunication that could be cleared up.
Okay, anything else on code of ordinances discussion? Councilor Mankey.
Do you have an idea when this report will come back to us, or these issues will come back to us?
I will try and get a timetable out of the town attorney.
Thank you.
Anything else? Do we have any appointments?
No.
We do have tax refunds. Councilor Budrejko.
Resolved that property tax refunds in the amount of $3,815.71 are hereby approved in the individual amounts and for those named on the request for refund of an overpayment of taxes certified by the revenue collector, a list of which is attached to this resolution.
Second.
Second by Councilor Nagel. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Passes 9-0. Minutes of previous meetings. We've got a bunch of them. Can I get a motion to accept the minutes as published?
So moved.
Moved by Councilor Dubino. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Marachini. Corrections, additions.
I have one minor thing. On the April 25th regular meeting minutes, my name is misspelled in the first half of the minutes, and in the second half it's spelled correctly. So if someone would just
consistency,
recheck.
As I was taught, is second only to accuracy. So
correct, and it's spelled N-A-G-E-L.
Are there any other corrections? There was one, and I was hustling to find it, and I can't find it quickly, where a John Sylvia was identified as a speaker during public participation. It should be Stephen Sylvia. And I'm trying to find the date, but if we can find it, that would be a help. All those in favor of accepting the minutes as corrected? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Minutes are accepted unanimously. Written oral communications from the town manager, et cetera, et cetera. Moving right along, council liaison and committee reports. Councilor Nagel.
I recently attended a CROG meeting, and at that meeting they emphasized the economic development, and that CROG was, along with Metro Hartford, going to do an outreach to the towns concerning economic development and what things would best help individual towns. I don't know whether they have done that now or not. Also, the Capital Region of Councils has put together a public participation plan having to do with transportation. If the town manager doesn't have a copy of this, I have a copy of it, which I'll gladly give her, about fast track and other things. Recently attended a NCTV meeting. The important thing about that is that they have been tagging their equipment and materials. They were going to do it anyways, but it's like anticipation for the hoped renovation of Town Hall in the new building. They're about 90% done. They also discussed the Memorial Day Parade, which, of course, I hope we all participate in, and also about additional needs that are needed for their truck, which you now will see very prominently placed in the town parking lot in an approved place, I hope, for NCTV. I recently attended a library meeting. At that meeting, there was a discussion with the chairperson of the Town Hall Renovation Committee and the architect of the Town Hall Renovation Committee, where they presented the latest version of what the new revised Town Hall north-south location would look like. It's an evolving process. Why did they go to the library and talk with them? Well, the library has a more of an input in relationship to the Town Hall. More specifically, the concerns about parking during the renovation process for library participants. And there were several suggestions that were made and talked about in terms of what might be able to be done, including putting a parking lot on the library, Friends of the Library owned property. And the library was also concerned about access to the facility while the renovation was going on, because staging areas have to be placed in several different locations. It was a lengthy, helpful discussion, and hopefully it will continue, and they also asked a great deal about other things concerning the town hall itself. It went to them because of the reasons that I've mentioned, and I'm sure it will go to others, and hopefully eventually will come here in a more finalized process. Library also discussed the race, their annual relay race, which is being held on the 21st of May. The race starts at 9:30 a.m. for those of us that want to sign up and put on our running shoes. And also a final report of the library renovation feasibility study has come to the library and has been given to the board itself, and that's an ongoing process as well. If Mr. Maricini wants to talk about town hall renovation, please do so, and I'll give information.
Now, you summed it up pretty well. The architect this past last week came out with, I guess, plan three, either on his own or directed by whomever, but it essentially takes Town Hall and pushes it further east toward the library. So detaches it from where, so basically build it in the parking lot.
Okay.
Along Mazzacoli Way, detaches it from the police station and everything. So if you're a believer in campus feel, that truly would be it, because it's multiple buildings on essentially a parcel of land. It works better with the huge struggle that is swing space. You know, we discussed that our last meeting. So it'll take a portion of the expense out of it. You know, and that doesn't all go away because we still have to move, and even whether it's internally and some parts of the building will still have to come down to make it happen. But it was the consensus of the committee to let them further divulge into that plan so Downs Construction can actually vet it and price it out and schedule it, which is why we don't have a meeting for a couple of weeks. Well, three, I guess, basically. One of them was because Downs just had something else that they needed to commit to. But so the 25th of May, I believe.
Yes.
Which is a Thursday, note. They should have all that information for us. And hopefully there'll be some tweaks. But my plan is, I mean, it seems like wholeheartedly we're heading in the right direction. So if we can, there's a couple of minor issues that if those are taken care of, I think we'll have a good support and be ready.
I think we should also add there was a discussion about storage in the latest version. The
Hence
architect didn't include that. Yeah, and some people think there isn't storage there. We did address that, and at the library meeting, it was addressed as well, that storage will be provided with, at this point, I believe, a half cellar, meaning half of the town hall building will have a basement that will be available for storage, not only for the town side, but also the Board of Ed side, which was a bone of contention. And in this latest conversion, NCTV and Human Services is not going to be in the bottom area of the cellar, so to speak, hate to put it so crudely, but will be extended to the side between the community center and the town hall as previously proposed, which seems to make sense for a variety of reasons, which we'll get to later. The presentation, a schedule is being worked out and presented so that indeed, hopefully, more than hopefully, by the fourth week in June, a town council meeting, that the town renovation committee will come before you with what we have so that it can go forth within the state mandated number of days that things can be worked out so that the referendum definitely can be held on election day. We're diligently all cooperatively trying to, and we're going to meet that deadline. Hopefully that's definite. And there will be public hearings in the future. So the public is not being left out at special places, but there's a process that obviously we all know one has to go through.
Any other?
You pointed to me.
You know.
You all done?
Well, are you done?
Discussion at another
done?
Meeting.
Okay.
So go ahead.
You went over your 3 minutes, though. I was at the Aging Commission on Aging Disabled meeting on Wednesday evening. Just so everybody can mark it in their calendars, the volunteer dinner is going to be May 25th at 5 p.m., and you have a town hall rental meeting that night.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Oh.
And then the other thing, and I'm pretty impressed that Diane Stone was appointed to the Senior Center Task Force at the state level. And usually the chairman is somebody from the Senate or somebody from the House. But she was appointed chairman of that task force.
Nice.
So that says a lot for our for Diane and for what she has done for our town and for our senior center. So I wanted to definitely bring that up to you. And that's about it.
And I came in at the second half of the meeting. That's why I looked over.
And I
Counselor
left.
Anis, and we made an agreement. They were doing a self-assessment review, which is a policy and forms that need to be done every year. And they continued to do that and will at their next meeting.
Counselor Sarah?
I'm going to talk about Parks and Rec. I was not at the meeting last time because we had a meeting last month. But there's a fundraiser for Life Be In It at Chipotle's on May 22nd from 4 to 9. If you bring the flyer in and let the cashier know that 50% of the proceeds are going to the Life Be In It extravaganza. So they're raising money with that. Also, next week on May 18th from 5 to 9 at Mill Pond is Motorcycle Madness, which I'm looking forward to. I saw that it was going to be a sunny day, so let's keep our fingers crossed.
That always helps, a sunny day with
motorcycles. That's right, in the 70s, so it looks great. It looks like it's going to be a win all around for everybody, and I hope we have a huge turnout this year like we did last year.
Last year was fantastic, and this year, so far, it looks like it's going to exceed last year, so it would be a good time for all.
I hope so.
Good time for all. Any other liaison reports? If not, public participation in general. Ms. Lyons, you know the drill. If you're watching on NCTV, the number is 860-665-8736.
Rose Lyons, 46 Elton Drive. First of all, I appreciate the MDC commissioners coming to the table and bringing the information that they brought to us tonight. But I, too, like Councilor Annist, thought that I heard Commissioner Payne indicate that the informational hearing would be September in 2018. So it was very hard to follow the timeline. And I won't go over it because it'll take up too much of my 3 minutes. But I would like to see something in the minutes of this meeting as to what the exact timeline is, or on the town website, and even their contact information. There's a lot of discussion with people on projects with MDC, and I've communicated with the town engineer regarding a clean water project in the back of my property, and I know that there's a woman over on Wilbur Drive, or Wells Drive North, that is waiting for the MDC to do some work with the clean water project. They come here, they give the informational sessions. I was at the one on Cedar Street, the last I knew, there was a holdup with the easement, and I've been asking and asking and asking and have no answers from town staff other than it's being looked at, and tonight, all of a sudden, it's here. So I think it would be nice if the public would be informed of it. Also, there was an informational session regarding the exit ramp on Route 175 by the proposed defunct Amara property. There's certain projects that are, they come here, like I say, they give their information, and then you never hear back from them again. Alumni Road's been discussed, but years in past, Veterans Landing, an assisted living project for the Veterans Hospital, has been discussed as well. And I think when you're, if it were me, I'd want to know what else is being discussed around the area where I'm going to be making a decision on. It's just my own personal opinion. As far as the town hall renovation, long time in between meetings, I'm glad to hear that the chair and the architect went to the library building committee, but those meetings, as far as I know, are not televised, and I don't know that I even have seen any minutes on them. I would like to see the library board people come and say that they agree with what is being proposed by town hall reno. I know at the last round, the library said yes, and the last minute they said no. So I'd like to see somebody show up at a town hall reno meeting from the library board. I think that it's important that there's communication between them, town hall reno, and especially the public. And I made that clear the last time I was there, that I think that we should have some informational meetings before the public hearings. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? No one come forward, seeing nothing on the telephone. Remarks by councilors. Councilor Budrejko.
Yeah, I just would like to ask the town manager. Last year at this time, there was an awful lot of controversy, and the hot topic was the cemetery cleanup. This year, I noticed the communication was much improved. I mean, I've seen notices and whatever, but apparently there are still some issues or people who either are concerned or they're have some comments. So one of the things that we discussed last year was a cemetery sexton. So I was just wondering what the status of that is, if we're going to move forward with that or not, because I know that was one of the resolutions we had thought would resolve some of the issues.
Well, there still is not a sexton, and for a variety of reasons, it's not something that's been pursued. That's where that issue stands. And specifically, I guess, who would you, you know, I wrestle with who to appoint as the sexton. That's what my concern is.
Okay.
I wonder if there should be further discussion on
this. Yeah, I'd like to, because we didn't promise it, but we did tell the public that that would be a possible solution to some of this, just overall issues of cemetery management. So maybe we could reopen that.
Can you just make a note to add that to a future agenda?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Any other? Councilor Nagel.
Just a comment from what Ms. Lyons had mentioned for information. I hope it wasn't implied to you or to anyone else that the library approved or disapproved of what was going on. It was merely discussion. It's an ongoing thing, and was presenting alternatives and getting the library board's input. So there, it was a productive meeting, but there was no call for anyone to say, this is it, this isn't it, or whatever. And there will be, I know, more discussions involving their concerns in the future. I do know that the architect is, and I'm sure the rest of us are very aware, that we want to keep the library open and accessible, and that there be parking available to the those there with whatever comes down the pike. So they did not approve. They did not disapprove. That wasn't the reason for going there. It was merely to open a discussion about how it affects them.
Councilor Sarah.
Just getting back on the cemetery, I noticed, and I saw Gail brought up about there's some concerns going on right now. There's concerns that there's eternal lights being taken off of the stones, and people are really concerned now what else is going to be taken, or there's going to be nothing left in the cemetery anymore. And there was a picture of them on the back of one of the trucks being taken away. So I'm really concerned if that's all there was an eternal light that was left there, and they're taking those away.
I'm not familiar with these complaints. I know Roy will have, or the mayor during his office hours, will have some folks come in and talk to him, and he does forward those to me for answers. And I'm aware of one instance that I think has been resolved at this point. So I can't speak with any intelligence
and
to
this,
what you
this
just
was
brought
just,
forward.
This was just posted today.
Right.
Okay.
And there's only three.
There was comments. Like, there was four lights on the back of the truck.
I'm curious.
The West Meadow.
I was trying to remember from the ordinance. I think there was language in there about not having glass.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if that was why. Because I was trying to think, why in the world would that be an exception or be a problem? That's the only thing I could think of in our discussions from last year. So if we could just check into that. Because I agree, it doesn't seem
right. But I don't know if they were glass or not, or just
I don't know what they were.
Acrylic plastic,
right? But I'm wondering. I know the. I mean, we put that out last year. We all read it, but there was a lot to it, so it's hard to remember. But I read that post today. And I'm thinking, why in the world would that be issue? But that was all I could come up with, was if they were glass or something like that. But we have to check that.
Where was that posted? I assume.
What's happening?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other council comment? If not, we need a motion to adjourn to executive session on the topic of contracts and real estate to include town council, town manager, economic development director, Tanya.
For one of the topics.
For one of the topics.
For
first topic.
First topic for the contract.
Okay.
I mean for real estate.
No, for real estate.
For real estate.
So it will be Town Council, Town Manager, Economic Development Director for the real estate portion. Subject will be real estate and contracts. There a motion?
So moved.
Counselor Nagel, is there a second? Second, Counselor Maricchini. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, let's gather across the hall in 5 to 10.
I want my iPad back.